So we've talked a lot about regression, but sometimes what we want to do with a machine learning model is make a classification. Is it A or not A? Is it spam or not spam? Is the puppy cute or not cute? Now, we can use logistic regression as a foundation for classification by taking our probability outputs and applying a fixed threshold to them. For example, we might decide to mark something as spam if it exceeds a spam probability of 0.8. That 0.8 is our classification threshold. Now, once we've chosen to make a classification threshold, how are we going to evaluate the quality of that model? We need some new metrics. Our regression metrics aren't sufficient. One classic way of evaluating classification performance is to use accuracy. And by accuracy, we mean count all the things you got right and divide it by all the things that there were. It's basically what percentage of the things did you get correct. Interestingly enough, even though accuracy is a very intuitive and widely used metric, it has some key flaws. In particular, accuracy breaks down when we have class imbalance in our problems. Imagine if we were to try and use accuracy to assess the quality of a model that is predicting ad click-through rates for display ads. In display ads, our click-through rates are often 1 in 1,000, 1 in 10,000, or even lower. So I might have a model that has absolutely no features in it, except for a bias feature that tells it to predict false always. This predict false always model would have an accuracy of 99.999% in display ads predictions, but would add absolutely no value. Clearly, accuracy is doing something wrong here. So to deal with class imbalance problems, we need a more fine-grained way of looking at the way that our models predict on positives and negatives, or different classes. So we can think about these different kinds of successes and different kinds of failures along a 2x2 grid that has true positives, false negatives, and true negatives. To help us understand these, let's remember the story of the little boy who cried wolf. Now, this little boy is a shepherd. The wolf comes to town. If he correctly spots the wolf, that's a true positive. He sees the wolf. He says, "Wolf!" True positive, saves the town. Good job. Now, a false positive is when that little boy says, "Wolf," but there really wasn't a wolf. That is a false positive. It makes everybody annoyed. A false negative may be even worse. A false negative, there was a wolf coming along, and the little boy was asleep or didn't see it, and the wolf went in and ate all the chickens. That's really no good at all. A true negative is when the boy did not cry wolf, and indeed, there was no wolf. Everything's fine. So we can combine these ideas into a couple of different metrics. One of them is precision, which is when the little boy said wolf, how many times was he right? How precisely was he able to say wolf? Recall, on the other hand, is of all of the wolves that tried to come into the village, how many did we get? Now, what's interesting is that these things are often in a little bit of tension. Because if you imagine that you want to do a better job at recall, the right thing to do is to be more and more aggressive about saying wolf, even when you just hear like a little noise off in the bushes. So we can think of that as lowering our classification threshold. But if we want to be really precise, the right thing to do is to only say wolf when we're absolutely sure. So we might think of that as raising our classification threshold. So these two metrics are often in tension, and doing well at both of them is important. It also means that whenever someone tells you what the precision value is, you need to also ask about the recall value before you can say anything about how good the model is. Now, precision and recall are both well defined when there is one specific classification threshold that we've chosen. But we might not know in advance what the best classification threshold is going to be. And we still want to know if our model is doing a good job. Well, a reasonable thing we could do would be to try and evaluate our model across many different possible classification thresholds. And in fact, we have a metric that looks at the performance of our model across all possible classification thresholds. And this is called an ROC curve, Receiver Operating Characteristics Curve. And the idea is that we evaluate every possible classification threshold and look at the true positive and false positive rates at that threshold. We then draw a little curve that connects those dots, and the area under that curve has an interesting probabilistic interpretation. It goes like this. If I were to pick a random positive example, you know, closing my eyes, I pick one out of our distribution, and I pick a random negative example, what's the probability that my model will correctly assign a higher score to the positive than it does to the negative. In a sense, what's the probability it gets that little pairwise order incorrect? Turns out that that probability is exactly equal to the probability value of the area under the ROC curve. So if I see a value of 0.9 area under ROC, that's the probability that I will get that pairwise comparison correct. One last measure to think about is prediction bias. Now, prediction bias is defined by taking the sum of all of the things that we predict and comparing them to the sum of all the things we observe. Basically, we would like the expected values that we predict to be equal to the observed values. If they're not, we say that the model has some bias. A bias of 0 would show that the sum of the predictions equals the sum of the observations. Now, bias is a very simplistic metric in that it's easy to fool. We could have a model that has almost no value to it. It just predicts the mean of all the class probabilities to create a zero bias model. However, it's a useful canary, because if one of our more complicated models does not have zero bias, it means that something is going on. It gives us something to dig into as a way to debug our models. So if our model does not have zero bias, it's definitely cause for concern and allows us to maybe slice the data and see what areas the model is not doing a good job of having zero bias on. However, just having zero bias by itself is not an indicator that the model is perfect. We need to keep looking at other metrics for that. We can look at more fine-grained views of bias by looking at a calibration plot. And with a calibration plot, what we do is we take groups of data, we bucket them up, and look at the mean prediction versus the mean observation for things in that bucket. Obviously, we do need to have buckets of data to make calibration be meaningful. For example, if I'm looking at flipping a coin, any given coin flip will either come up exactly heads or exactly tails, you know, basically exactly 1 or exactly 0. But my probabilistic predictions will be 0.5 or 0.3 or some value in between 0 and 1. So it only makes sense to compare those mean predictions to mean observations if I aggregate across a sufficiently large number of them.